since you were brought up with the background of architects in your own house, what particular aspects of your upbringing have shaped your design principles and philosophies?
See, when my mother was still in the final year architecture, I was in her stomach when she gave a design viva. So people joke that I'm the Abhimanyu of architecture, and I learned architecture when I was still in the womb. So for me, the architecture has always been a part of my journey since I was growing up. The way we started in a very humble rented house when we started off, and the way the house was kept was the first inspiration to us.
Indrajit Kembhavi and Neeta Kembhavi, two prominent personalities in the architectural domain, are our guests for today's episode. They are the principal architects of an award-winning firm, CAF, that is Kembhavi Architecture Foundation in Bangalore. Indrajit Kembhavi has worked extensively in varied sectors ranging from large-scale townships to interior design and villas, with the motto to provide contextually relevant green architecture. He talks about his journey throughout learning, practicing and teaching architecture in this podcast. Neeta Kembhavi, on the other hand, is a passionate artist who is deeply influenced by mythology and nature. She's worked on some phenomenal art projects, namely Benares, Seascape, Abstract, Cityscape, and many more. From being an architect to also practicing art as a passion, she's spoken about some wonderful experiences that keep inspiring her. Watch this episode to gain some really wonderful insights from this power couple and to know their perspective on architecture today. So first of all, I welcome you both to Art Town podcast series. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So before we begin the actual conversation, I would like to ask you, how are you and how is this pandemic situation treating you?
We are all fine, touch wood so far, in this difficult situation that's going all around with the second wave coming in. In terms of work, I think after the first wave, and the pandemic started dying down in the first wave, I think the economy bounced back. And because of that, all of us have been pretty busy with our work. And the second wave is unexpected now, for which we are now trying to reorganize our work, reorganize our office, reorganize the way we are working. And though we are extremely busy with our work, we are trying to find methodologies on how we can address these challenges and work through it and wait through it seamlessly. And at the same time, try and keep ourselves, our team, our clients safe.
Glad to know that you both are safe. It's a tough time for all of us, I'm sure, but we're going to get through this. Moving on, I would say that Kembhavi Architecture Foundation is led by a family of six architects. So could you give us a brief about the journey of KAF and the wide range of work that you do?
See, KAF was started by my parents, Sharad Kembhavi and Nalini Kembhavi, in 1972 in Hubli, which is the second biggest city in Karnataka. And it was a time when architecture was not very well known in that area, and it was the desire of my parents to spread awareness of architecture into the region where they were born. And from there, the journey of CAF started. We started working as a small humble practice out of a home, and then it spread to offices, and the size of offices grew, the range of practice grew, and slowly we started working all over the country. In the year 1997, Neeta and me got married, and a new dimension was added to our office with her entry into the system and my entry into the system. When we started working together, we brought in new elements of work, we brought in technology, we brought in computerization to the office, and then I think slowly the office started booming. After that, my younger brother Parth and his wife Soumya also joined the office around 13 years ago, and then it was a team of six architects. And we started working along, and we opened an office in Bangalore. And by God's grace, with the best wishes of our clients, a very, very supportive team, and a lot of well wishes, I think our practice has grown all across the country, and we are also doing some jobs abroad today. And we are extremely happy to state that we are having the privilege and opportunity to work on very exciting projects. One thing that we believe in CAF as a philosophy is that we try to look at each project with the same amount of passion, whether it's a small project or a very large one. And it is because of this passion that not only we as promoters have, but that the entire team has, that we are very proud to say that we have 100% repeat clientele. and they keep us going, and we also add a lot of new clients every year. So this has been our strength of CAF. Another passion with our company has always been green buildings, green architecture. We did among the first solar passively designed projects in the country with the IGP office Gulbarga, the Institute of Naturopathy and Yogic Sciences in Gadag. So we believe that every project has to be economical, has to be sustainable, has to be green. At the same time, the designs have to be cutting edge and they should relate to the context while standing out and making a statement. But it should also be tuned to the end user's requirement so their dreams are fulfilled. So we look at ourselves as directors who put across the and blend the dreams of our clients and make it into reality.
That's great. It's a wonderful spectrum of work that you're into, and CAF has certainly broadened its extent over the years. My next question is to you, sir. Since you are brought up with the background of architects in your own house, what particular aspects of your upbringing have shaped your design principles and philosophies?
Yeah, actually, like when my mother was still in the final year architecture, I was in her stomach when she gave a design viva. So people joke that I'm the Abhimanyu of architecture, and I learned architecture when I was still in the womb. So for me, the architecture has always been a part of my journey since I was growing up. The way we started in a very humble rented house when we started off, and the way the house was kept was the first inspiration to us. The passion of my parents, and when they started designing very beautiful projects all across our own offices, our own homes, then the homes of our clients, then the larger projects. It was a very beautiful infusion of ideas that came in. My parents also started the School of Architecture in Hubli in KLE Institute. And they used to invite a lot of architects from all across the country. And we had a privilege of interacting with a lot of great talents and inspirational figures from all over the country. Being a small kid and being a part of these discussions and conversations around the design table simulated the seed of design into our heart. And it became a passion, and the motivation was so strong that we could not think of any other profession but architecture. And though my wife also comes from a very different background, her family was into movies. So essentially that's also a very creative line, and I think she also brought in a lot of creative talents, and she was always passionate about art from her childhood. So the infusion of art and architecture culminated when we got together, and I think it's just been a very, very strong journey of, you know, like a lot of dedication, passion and love for our work.
Beautiful, sir. That's a very beautiful story, and it is a very interesting way to put it. I was getting to Neeta ma'am on a similar question that, ma'am, what originally made you want to study architecture, and how has this journey been for you?
See, talking about the journey, Inder already, you know, kind of elaborated how it has been. It has been very interesting, you know, starting from two different cities. Initially, when we started off, it was a smaller city, that is Hubli, wherein the kind of exposure and the kind of work we did was very different from what we are doing right now. But that also gave us an experience of, you know, on-site, design and build kind of an experience, which was very hands-on. And also the variety of projects what we worked on was very interesting. We did some ashrams, we worked with, of course, the green buildings, we did residences, we did a lot of institutes. And later part of our journey, we moved to Bangalore, where the scale of projects was varied. We are handling large projects. So it has been an interesting journey, I would say. As far as about me taking up architecture, I think art was always a part of my life. I mean, it was always a part of me growing up. And architecture, they say, is the mother of all arts. So I think that was a very naturally, I was inclined towards architecture, which is a form of art, I would say. So I think it's a beautiful mix of art and architecture when it comes to me.
Wonderful. As you said, and I've also read that you're an incredible artist. I went through some of your works online, and I must say they're all phenomenal. So as someone who has been so passionate about art, what do you think has been the biggest influence on your work, and what keeps you going?
See, art or architecture has influence of people, space, places, you know, they all have a kind of influence on your work. Similarly in art, I feel initially I was in a lot of landscapes and seascapes. So the sea kind of, you know, I painted a lot of landscapes. later I happened to visit Banaras, and that somehow, I don't know, kind of made such an impression that I have a series on Banaras. And being, you know, seeing Banaras from an architect's point of view also, I think, made a lot of difference. So I could depict the water, that's the Ganga, and the architecture, which is so varied. So that was my Banaras series. And then I moved on to my circle series, which I called Mind and Meditation. So it's about cosmos, it's about space, and there is a spiritual bent to it. And finally, that again led me to my, you know, my series on Samudra Manthan. So
I think mythology got...
Yeah, mythology was also spirituality, and it's, I think spiritual and mythology also played a lot of role in my art, I would say.
Wow. What you said was indeed very motivational for us. Anyone series of artwork that is particularly close to your heart?
Mandara, the mountain. So then I went to the Vishnu Avatara, the Kurma Avatara in the second one. And then taking forward the Neelakanta, the Shiva in, you know, wherein he takes the halahala, the poison, and how he saves the universe. So that way I'm taking that series forward, and that's closest to my heart, I would say.
That's great. I think all of your works are absolutely amazing. And now that both of you have worked on numerous range of specialized projects collectively, I would like to ask both of you, could you elaborate on your experience working with any one project that particularly taught you a lot?
We cannot say a single project has taught us a lot.
Each one, I think, has a different...
Each one has its own nuance, each one has its own learning and teaching that goes by. A smaller project, but we design a very micro project, I think we go very deep into the details, and you know, like we have to address every wall, like the interior of a house, or you know, like a small home, where we look at very small nuances. Whereas when you work on an extremely large project, it's the broader thing that happens, how it affects the community, how it affects the traffic, and you know, how it affects the environment. So the challenges that each project presents are very, very unique, very, very varied. Like we had a very unique example, a very unusual project that we designed was a prison actually. And then what we understood is that the psychology of the prisoners is so different that we thought that we should brighten up their lives and, you know, get in some sunlight inside and, you know, try to refresh the whole ambience. Even the jailers who work there are very disturbed mentally. The prisoners obviously are mental wrecks. So it was something where we understood the importance of psychology. But then this same learning we carried on to our other projects, where we now look at psychology, how a house can be bright, how a house can be beautiful, how skylights can impact, how colors can impact the psychology of a human being. So you know, it is like learnings are cross projects, and these projects, the learning is not limited only to a certain type of projects, but they are crossovers. So what we learn in one project is taken over to the next, and that is how we feel that the learning experience never stops. And I feel today, like initially, like when we start, we are bursting with energy and enthusiasm. As we grow over a period of time, we have experience. The key in a profession is to always remain mentally young and enthusiastic. We should not let the burden of experience overwhelm us, but taking the advantage of experience, we should always keep our enthusiasm and energy high. I think this is the biggest learning that we get across projects.
And that's the thing about this profession, I think. Each project has its own, you know, nuances, and we literally grow from project to project, I would say. And each project is a learning curve, because that's so varied, you know. That's the thing about architecture, which and the part about being creative, whatever the kind of project may be.
Absolutely, absolutely right. And I agree that we keep evolving with every experience, and we grow and keep getting better. Now we move on to the topic that is most spoken about these days, that is sustainability. It has suddenly become the flavor of the season. You, however, have been practicing green architecture long before it became fashionable. So having worked on a variety of residential projects particularly, how do you think sustainability, affordability, and modern architectural style go in hand in hand?
See, people always, you know, like are fooled by imagery. People just feel that by using natural materials like stone, exposed brick, etc., are green buildings. It's not so. Green buildings is not a very, very superficial thing. It's a very deep thing. A green building is something which does not damage the environment, But at the same time, it revives the environment and also creates a very good micro condition for the inhabitant who is living inside. Whether it is in terms of climate, whether it's in terms of humidity, temperature, the kind of air that we breathe, the quality of air, a toxin-free air. And in today's world, the biggest challenge is becoming radiation. So there are a lot of companies which are coming up with, you know, radiation management, because radiation is becoming the biggest evil today and causing a lot of diseases. So managing of all these things on one side to create a human comfort condition or an animal comfort condition is what we look at. And while we are creating these comfort conditions, what we have to ensure is that we damage the environment in a minimal way. And how do we do it? One is by optimizing the resources. Like, we try to use resources which have a very good self-embedded energy. In the sense, what we say is that, you know, something which has to be transported from thousands of kilometers away just for the heck of it. Or, you know, something which to manufacture it burns a lot of resources. These are kind of things that we should not do. You know, so there is definitely an impact to the environment. We cannot, there's always a relationship between cause and effect. So we can never stop our development because it's pertinent. But how we minimize the damage to the environment, how we can conserve water, how we can recreate a water table on the site, how we can use energy, whether it's wind, solar, etc. The kind of lighting that we use, the quality of water, quality of paint, everything goes into making a particular building green. And air conditioning. Air conditioning is one of the biggest consumers of energy in the world. We all know, I think even every child is taught that it depletes the ozone layer. But more and more buildings are becoming air conditioned. And air conditioning is a way that is something that is required for thermal comfort. But there are other ways by which we can cool the environment and reduce the level of air conditioning that we use by around 50%, 60%, 70%. So that the damage is minimal. So this is how we have to approach green buildings extremely holistically and try to look at making the whole world sustainable.
That is a wonderful approach, sir. It is very insightful. And I think sustainability has to be reflected in our thought process itself and has to be actually implemented rather than just talking about it. And CAF is undoubtedly inspiring a lot of architects out there to take it up. My next question to both of you is, how would you describe the current architecture scenario in India?
I think we architecture in India, I feel, is finally evolving. Initially, I think there was a lot of Western and the Eastern influence, as I can, you know, say. But now I feel finally we are coming on our own. We have a certain style wherein we are, taking in a lot from our past, our history, our local architecture. So finally, I think the Indian architecture is evolving to a very, it has a certain form, shape, style, which I think we are getting comfortable with. So be it tropical, be it modern, I think there's so much of other nuances which are being added into the stylization of a house or a space, which is very Indian to it. There's an Indianness to it now, finally.
And also with that, it is the responsibility, there lies the responsibility in the architect also. So what do you think is the role of an architect working today to sort of improve the condition of architecture in India?
See, architecture is essentially a combination, it's actually a science molded by art, or it's art molded by science. It's something where we use our logical thinking to its fullest as well as our creativity to the fullest. So it's a combination of the left and right brain, which is what makes this profession very unique, unlike most of the other professions. So when we look at architecture holistically, we feel that a lot of clients come to us with a dream. They come to us with an aspiration to build a house. Now, some of them want something functionally, some of them want something visually. But architecture is something beyond all that. It is something like this, I don't remember who said it, but they said that first you build your buildings and then the buildings build you. So what happens is that we have an extremely important role when we design our buildings, because it determines a way of life. People are used to living in a certain way of life and they feel it's right. But as an architect, we are people who try to understand. It's like studying history and creating a context. So we try to analyze each of our clients in a great amount of detail, whether it's their lifestyle, whether it's their religious beliefs, whether it's their cultural conditioning, whether it's their economical spend that they want to do, whether it's their likes, their dislikes. you know, once we analyze all these ingredients, it's like a doctor taking a prescription or taking a patient's medical history. It's, I think what we do goes beyond that. Try to get under the skin of a client and then try to develop a design that suits him. But at the same time, we add a lot of parameters that we draw from across the world, whether it's in terms of technology, design ideology, the context, the climate, certain things which a client would not be able to express but would want it within the depths of his heart. And these are things I feel that as a responsible architect, we try to merge a client's aspiration with, you know, like a lot of, and mold it with a lot of other facts and, you know, like principles of design, construction, technology that we learn across and get it to build an ideal habitat, whether it's a home or whether it's any kind of project.
That's a wonderful way to put it, sir. And it was very insightful. Moving on, sir, you are also into teaching architecture. Like, I myself had enrolled for a mentorship program by you. So, as someone who has mentored students, what changes would you like to see in the architectural education in the country?
Yeah, we feel that it's a very, very strong opinion. Both me and Neeta, we feel that, you know, like, the way education is structured in our country is essentially to pass exams. It's not about learning. So we feel that learning is a very important part of understanding the whole process. It's not only architecture, whatever subject that we work in. So the whole point, what we believe is that, you know, the context of architecture, the philosophy of architecture, the whole process of architecture is what should be taught at the first year level. So where people start understanding and appreciating architecture. So once you start doing that, and then you start getting into details and compartmentalization, where people start getting skill sets. One is getting the concept right, second is getting the skill sets. So, you know, you cannot do anything without good skill sets. But skill sets, application of skill sets are very clear only when you understand the whole concept. So we believe that initially a concept has to be taught. Why are you doing architecture? What's the reason for doing architecture? What's the reason for doing architecture in a certain way? And why did the greats do architecture in a certain way that has influenced the world in so many different ways? Once I feel the students are clear on that, they understand the importance of the profession, they start respecting their profession, I am sure they would be desperate to hone their skill sets and take them to the next level and, you know, play a very vital role in revitalizing the whole profession. So today technology is available across. Architecture is not limited only to design, understanding the nuances of construction, understanding softwares, understanding new technologies of construction, trying to adapt all these different parameters into a day-to-day practice. I think these are things a student should understand. And exploration, opening up to exploration, opening the mind to exploration is the key. So we feel that every student should have to go through this process where first we open up their mind and then they fill it up with technology and skill sets so that they become extremely successful.
And exposure to actual work as well. I feel what happens is you study architecture for so many years and then you go into internship. I feel in between, I think the internship was in between on the third year or so, in the middle of all the semesters, which also would be a good idea from point of, if you look at it from a point of the student. So he studies architecture, then he knows exactly what happens in a real working space. You go to a site, you look at projects, you work in an office. Because there's so much what you study in college and what happens in an office can be very different. And the speed at which a intern, you know, a fresher goes through the kind of the whole process of working in an office, you know, it gives a different kind of exposure, and that's where the reality is. I feel it should be a balance of both what is taught in college and the exposure in the office. And if it can happen simultaneously, that will be fantastic. So they can relate to what they're doing in college to what they're learning in the office much better.
Yes, I absolutely relate to it. I think the curriculum goes on very theory based, and somewhere the skill sets are lacking. And when we step onto the site or go for internships, it is suddenly like there are many things that we don't know actually, like how they are actually implemented. Yeah, so it is a very interesting approach, and I would honestly love to see some of these ideas getting implemented. On a closing note, I would like to ask both of you, what is the best advice that you've received so far, and what advice would you like to give young architects and artists today?
Advice, okay, I don't know, advice I will not say, But architecture is a lot of hard work. I think art and architecture both require a lot of hours you have to put into it. It's not the skill or whatever. I feel something about this profession actually needs you to be totally involved. To improve, to evolve in your field of art or architecture, it's the time you put into it, the effort, the mind. It's all about keeping your mind open. And, I feel you should expose yourself to whatever different kinds of styles as possible before you arrive at something. I feel you should not get, totally into the, this is my style and this is what I'm going to do. Expose yourself, open up yourself, open your minds, learn whatever comes your way. And then I think that will slowly lead you to what you actually will be comfortable doing or what your passion lies in. So that's my advice and that's how we have taken our journey.
To add on to that, I feel one has to be bold. One has to take risks to try out things. One should not be stuck in a shell. One should cross over boundaries which they have not crossed before. One, I feel that people have to be very, very explorative and creative. And particularly for the pandemic times, I have a special advice that I would like to give everyone on this note. I studied in Belgaum Military School and we were taught the army and the commando way of life. So in this pandemic times, when the whole world is going through a tough time, we were only taught one thing in our school, that is when the going gets tough, the tough get going. So I feel this is a time that we all have to be very strong, we have to be very tough, we have to be very careful, but at the same time we should not stop and we should keep going ahead with full zeal and enthusiasm.
Yes, absolutely. It was a wonderful conversation and you gave some really interesting insights and lots of motivation and takeaways to take from this. Thank you for joining us, Indrajit sir and Neeta ma'am. It was an absolute pleasure talking to you and it was my honor personally and I got to learn a lot from this conversation and I'm sure our listeners will also learn a lot. So thank you for joining us.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations to all of you who made it till the end. Thank you for listening to this episode and I really hope you liked it. If you did, please leave us a review on our YouTube comment section. And if you come up with any questions while listening to this podcast, you can add a comment on Instagram or YouTube. And we will get back to you and help you as much as possible. You can find us on Instagram or our website by the name arttown.store. So do connect with us. We're truly excited to converse with you.